This is the third episode of LVGL 9101. Today I'm going to show you how to create a basic layout. Ultimately, I think the reason for using LVGL is to create a nice looking good UI in an embedded environment. LVGL's documentation is great, but I think you can run much faster by creating it yourself. As you can see here, the UI we will create today is the Windows login screen. Of course, it's just UI layout. Nothing. It may seem a little difficult, but it's much easier to configure this screen than you might think. Let's get started right away. This is an image I found through Googling for this episode. I looked at a lot of other login screens, but this one looked great. It is a good idea to first plan what UI you will create. Next, I need to reconstruct the target UI I have set at the resolution of the device I will use. If images need to be updated at the UI level or button events are required, they must be detached, so each image must be prepared separately. Here, I prepared separate images for the user placeholder and the two icons below. Also, it is a good idea to roughly determine the size and position of each widget based on this resolution. Of course, you will have to make a few modifications to your code, but this can make things a lot easier. It will be a good idea to think about the widgets in the UI that will be used on the screen. For text, use the label widget, and for images, use the image widget to display them on the screen. Since you need to receive input from the user, you can use the text area widget to receive keyboard input. This is the basic project prepared in the previous episode. Let's get started from here. All of the code I'm going to use here is on my GitHub, so you don't have to type it out. Let's convert the image files to be used in this project into a format that can be used in LVGL. You can easily do this from the official image converter site supported by LVGL, since V8 and V9 are different, pre-check V9. By default, the image will use RGB 565, that is a 16-bit image. If the image you want to use has a transparency, you should use RGB 565:8:8. This increases the file size but allows you to use images with transparency, such as PNG files. Place the converted C files in the project folder, then you can now use these images. You can check the added files in the left window. Okay, it's coding time. I will create a UI init function and do all the work there. First, let's create a screen object. You can create any LVGL object using the lvobjcreate function. Here, through lvscreenactive, you can get the currently active screen. Through this, my screen object will be created based on the current screen. This screen object will be the parent object of the screen I will create. The result is a blank white canvas. We need to fill it out with other widgets. Now let's add the background image I prepared. In order to use an image, you must declare the image to use through the function called lvimageDeclare. Creating an image widget through lvimageCreate is created using the parent object, the screen object. By doing this, it becomes a form that is above the screen. This is called the parent-child structure. Set the converted background image as a source of the image widget. Finally, fix the position of the image widget to the center. Finally, the background image is visible on my device. Nothing yet, but I feel good. There are a few unintended parts here. First, you can see a white border. This is one of the default settings that the default UI object has. We can get rid of this by defining a style. You'll also see a scroll bar in the bottom right corner. This is because the image widget is larger than its parent widget. Due to the default padding in the image widget, the size is larger than the actual image. This can be solved by removing the parent object scroll bar or removing the padding of the image widget. Let's create a style to remove the white border. You can use it after initializing the style structure. After that, if we set the width to 0 in the set border width function, the border will disappear. Now you can add a new style by the function lvObjectAddStyle. Also, since we don't need a scroll bar, we can remove the lvObjectFlagScrollable flag from the screen. This creates a screen with no borders and no scroll bars. Next, let's add the user placeholder image. It's the same way as the background image, but this time the image position is top middle rather than center. We can align UI widgets anywhere. After determining alignment, you can move the position by setting the X and Y values again from there. You can understand this part right away after trying a couple of times. Be sure to try it for yourself. If you look at the result screen, you can see that the user placeholder image is slightly away from the top. This is because there are areas that are not visible due to the padding included in the image widget. I will leave it like this because it's in the right place without any extra change to the Y position. It's time to create the user label. To create a label widget, use the lvLabelCreate function, or set the parent object to the screen object. Set the text you want here. Change the text color and the font size. Change the size of text is not easy in LVGL. LVGL fonts, unlike regular fonts, contain bitmap information. So when an LVGL font is created, the size is defined together. This means that to change the font size, you need to corresponding LVGL font. I think we will have to talk about this again later. Let's place this label 30 pixels up from the center. Since we use Montserrat font size 24, let's not forget to enable this in lvconfig header file. Now you can see the text Windows Insider on my device. Next, we need to create a text area that can receive the user's password input. This widget can be very useful because it can receive input from a virtual keyboard. This placeholder text will be pinned. This widget sets the size. Input widgets usually specify the size and are displayed as dots when they exceed a certain length. You know what I'm saying, right? If you look at the widget screen, you can see that the text area has been created, but this is not the design we want. That's why we need to create a style and apply it again. This will be the same as we did above. After initialization of the style structure, set the desired settings. Here, we set the widget's corner radius to 0 to create a rectangle shape. After creating the style, don't forget to apply it via the addStyle function. Finally, the result I wanted was achieved. Very good. Next, we need to add text, sign-in options, and two icons. Before that, I'm going to create a panel and put all of these inside it. By doing this, if this part needs to be hidden for some reason later, it can be handled very easily. The menu panel I created is just an LV object and it can be contained all LV widgets. The first scan object I created was also an LV object. Let's create a sign-in label. The menu panel becomes the parent widget at this time. Now creating text label is very simple. Since the parent widget of this label is menu panel, the baseline of the alignment is also menu panel. Align to the top of menu panel. The menu panel also needs style. Let's create a style with a border of 0 and no background color. Also set the padding to 0 so there's no margin. Please don't forget to apply to menu panel. Now let's create two image buttons. Since this also uses an image, every image declarer must be used. The image button allows you to create a button with animation by adding various images. Additionally, you can create more effects by changing the images for each button state. Here, I will only create the simplest image button. And finally, align the button's position to both bottom ends of the menu panel. This completes the screen. To build and flash it to your device, because the image files are large, so need to select a huge app in the partition settings. After that, you can build and install it on your device. Layout composition is really fun. With just a few practices, you can create a great UI. Also, I believe it's the reason why we need LVGL. In the next episode, let's try to add some code needed to interact with the UI created today. That's it for today. See you in the next episode.